We have been busting DC Comics nuggets on the regular here on Best of the Week. And this week, we're going to have to bust on Marvel Comics nuggets because they don't have a damn comic book in here. We ain't recommending nothing for Marvel. We got three DC Comics. We got five indies. And here with me to talk about that is my good friend Drew from Comics Lead. How you doing, Drew?
I'm doing great, Wes. Been a busy week. And it was a very horror-centered week in the indies, for me at least. That's one thing I noticed.
It was. Yeah, both of my indie comics would be horror genre based. First up, I'm recommending Crimson Cage number 4 from AWA. John Lee's Alex Cormack once again. If you're an old school wrestling head like myself, this is probably going to be in your wheelhouse. If you like James E. Cornette, you probably like the sentiments of this comic book, but it's also got a lot of Shakespearean influence, i.e. it is absolutely lifting a story from Shakespeare and throwing it into wrestling. I still love the art. I love the way that they're doing it. I could see how some people would think the lingo that is being used maybe a little too inside baseball. I just think it's a really wonderful story. And this week, we see that the champion's reign is about to come to an end, and he's not happy about it.
Shame on me. I still haven't gotten around to reading it. Going back to rereading issue one, I know. It's just I've had a busy month.
Busy to read comic books.
Yeah, I know. I meant to yesterday, but yesterday got busier than I thought it would. But I'm going to try to, hopefully later this afternoon or tomorrow, get caught back up with Crimson Cage.
This is my recommendation for you, Drew. Stop reading the Wonder Woman, try out the Amazon stuff. I know it's DC, but it's all bad. There hasn't been a good page released yet, let alone an actual issue, and go and give you some time for Crimson Cage.
No, you're absolutely right, because I just started reading a lot of the DC books for next week, and it doesn't get much better with Wonder Girl, unfortunately.
Nah. I cannot scream from the rooftops loud enough in support of Crimson Cage. If you're a wrestling mark like myself, it's absolutely worth your time and effort. There's another comic that I definitely have to recommend. We've been talking about this one as well pretty much since we started the show, Shadow Man number 7 from Valiant Comics. This is the best Valiant comic series that's been released by them in probably 3 years since their last Ninja K series by Christos Gage. Cullen Bunn apparently can't get work at Marvel anymore because they're out of the Cullen Bunn business, but he's actually like writing the best comics of his life right now, which is very, very poor timing. But it's really the art from Pedro Andreu that really takes this issue to the next level, Drew. I was really shocked by this. This is like high-level comic book craftsmanship here, because you have the actual story, the battle that's brewing and happening in the background in the pages. It happens from the first page to the last. You don't need to read the dialogue. And then the dialogue that is there is just narration, obviously, from the first-person character, Shadowman himself, but he's not really narrating the events. It's almost two different stories happening at the same time, and it is done perfectly.
Yeah, you're absolutely correct. Like, we didn't talk about this beforehand, but I honestly told to Kyle during our review, this is probably some of the best work Cullen Bunn has ever done in his life. And he's putting on a writing clinic to a lot of the guys in Marvel and DC right now. And I told Kyle, and he agrees with me, that you really don't need to read the previous issues to jump in on this to understand what's going on. And he feels like if he had read the previous six, he probably would have been more invested in it, but which is true. But you really don't have to read the dialogue, the narration, but the narration is beautiful. I mean, I likened it to like Frank Miller from Daredevil Born Again back in the 80s, reading it during some of the events. And it is so much fun. It's terrifying. It's scary. I love this series. I love this issue. Shadow Man number 7. Cullen Bunn is putting on a clinic.
It's shocking what he was able to accomplish with this, because he really tells like there's an enormous battle happening. Mm-hmm. It all takes place, and there's a decisive moment in there, and Shadow Man's happened on the new, like, you get it all strictly through the visuals, and then the narration adds to it, but it's completely not necessary. Wonderful work on the part of Pedro Andreu. That was a beautiful work as far as the artist goes.
Yes, not Davis Hunt, but hey, this guy did a great job picking up for this horror center story, and yeah, loved it.
Yeah, I was surprised. Obviously, it wasn't the normal artist. Now let's go over to a comic book you and I both talked about when the number one issue came out. This is from Ablaze, which I'm an Ablaze guy now. Brock Lesnar is a Heyman guy. I'm an Ablaze guy. I'm down for the cause. Life Zero number 2, Stefano Vietti, Marco Cicchetto. Essentially, you've got commandos going against zombies. Obviously, last week they freed their commander that was kind of in a prison, and it's time to take out some more zombie apocalypse.
I loved it. I love this book. I love this series. And hey, we both said this before. We love maps, and we get a map, page one, and we see how pretty much next to impossible it's going to be for them to get from point A to point B. Marco Giacchetto's art in this, like, I was not expecting him to come back on issue two. I thought he was just going to do a one and done to kick it off. In my opinion, this art is better than his work on Devil's Reign and Daredevil right now. Like, this is legit top-notch Marco Giacchetto. I love it. His depictions of the emotions, the zombies, it is the surroundings is beautifully detailed. We really see just how well-paced this story is and how action-packed the zombie story can be. And these guys are putting on a clinic at Ablaze and Life Zero.
Ablaze is kind of doing everything, right? Almost everything that they're putting out is worth your time. But Life Zero should definitely be at the top of the list. It's one of those, I don't want to say it's can't miss, but you shouldn't miss it because it's really, really good. I like that one a lot. You're also, essentially everything what we're recommending this week is horror if it's indie-based.
Yeah.
Let's go over to Scout Comics. This is the first of two that are kind of horror genre. This is out of the Scout Comics Black Caravan imprint, Pentagram of Horror number one, written and illustrated by Marco Fontanelli. I have not read this. I didn't even realize it came out this week. It looks interesting. What's going on in this book?
So effectively, this story comes down to one question. What's the price for talent? The art in this is damn beautiful. And I mean, this is what Silvercoin could be and should be. You know, I like Silvercoin, but this issue, they just show the guys, hey, look, we're doing it better with this one issue than what you guys have done. And it is amazing. Marco Fontanelli, he really is a talented artist. This is my first time learning about him. This is another guy put on a clinic this week, drawing stuff. And I can't recommend the story enough. You need to check this out from Scout.
Scout's another one of those publishers that don't get enough publicity for the amount of quality that they're putting out there. I think for like pound for pound, they're definitely one of the better small print publishers in comic books. Almost everything they put out is at minimum good. And there are definitely a lot of comics that they put out that are really great. Speaking of Scout, there's another comic you wanted to talk about. Rad Wraith number one, Tristan Gallagher and Christian Debari. This has an interesting cover. It looks like it is a skateboarding demon. Is that what's going on here?
It kind of pretty much. Yeah. So he was a kid and he's kind of like competing against some other skateboarding punks. And look, it's a fun horror story. And there's a infamous ramp half pipe that's in a cemetery that kids have skated on that have died before. And they say, hey, if you want to be with us, you got to escape. Yeah. You got to hit that ramp. Things may not go so well for him. But somehow he may or may not come back from the dead and may or may not be getting some revenge on these skateboarding punks in pretty brutal ways. It is a lot of fun. It's very reminiscent of, you know, Tales from the Crypt, Vault of Horror, Dash of the Crow as well, where it's like a revenge story, you know, coming back from the dead to get revenge. I thoroughly enjoy this. It's a very fun, creepy comic. And I think if you like those Tales from the Crypt stories, you will enjoy this.
We got no Marvel to talk about this week. This has never happened on the show where Marvel didn't at least put out one comic book that one of us would at least be like, yeah, this is something you should probably read. But Marvel, they didn't put out much this week. So I think that probably hurt their efforts. And just none of it was all that high quality.
Yeah, you're right. You know, we read everything from Marvel too. And Kyle and I think there was only one I could have maybe. It was the Watcher What If one, but I didn't really feel strong enough to recommend that. I didn't feel comfortable in recommending that book. It's just, nah. But the others were just kind of, just like a DC week, the previous few weeks.
Hey, thankfully, DC actually comes through. They had a pretty heavy publishing week, and we've got three DC comics to talk about. Mm-hmm. The first one I'm going to recommend, and I know if I didn't bring it up, you were going to recommend it. Mm-hmm. Batman, Superman, World's Finest number one, Mark Waid and Dan Moore. This thing is phenomenal. If you like old school comic book storytelling, this is the kind of comic book you're going to love. In the art by Dan Mora, I don't want to use the word flawless, but I should use the word flawless because it's essentially perfect. There's not a panel in here that doesn't look immaculate. You can tell that Dan Mora put his heart and soul into this, and Mark Waid really backs it up with a hell of a really good Batman, Superman, and Robin kind of adventure story with the three of them together. And this is something else I want to point out, Drew. So many times Marvel and DC spoil their own stories. I am so glad that they didn't tell me that Doom Patrol was going to be in this.
Yes.
Because it was so cool when they finally opened it up and then you see them. You're like, fucking Doom Patrol's in this too? It was just great.
I was grinning from ear to ear the entire time reading this comic. I really felt like a kid again. So much fun. We got heroes being heroes, villains being villains, Poison Ivy actually committing villainous acts. Poison Ivy treated like a villain again. Dan Mora, he put on an art clinic with this book. Say what you will about Mark Waid. Mark Waid, he knows these characters inside and out, and he just put on a clinic with this book. I mean, I've said that term quite a bit this week, but these guys have done a great job this week with these titles, and World's Finest is just the perennial, the paramount of putting on a clinic.
Yeah, it's really fantastic. I think it could throw a lot of newer readers off. If you've only been reading comic books maybe for the last 5-8 years, and you really haven't gone into some back issues, it might feel too fast-paced. It might feel like there's too much going on there, because yes, he does not waste a page or a panel. Like, this story is in motion the entire time, and it's very fast-paced.
Yes. One word I like to use, it's very kinetic. It's a very kinetic story. You know, it's always in motion. You're not stopping to read a page worth of dialogue in one bubble. It's fantastic. And Mark Waid gets pacing, and I got to applaud him for that. And he's done a great job, and he's set a high bar now. So really, hopefully issues 2 through whatever they're going to be, that they're amazing.
Definitely off to a good start. Now there's more from DC to talk about. We've been talking up the Flash. This week we get the Flash 780, Jeremy Adams, Fernando Passeret. Once again, another fantastic episode of the Flash. We're finally getting that Wally West family story we always asked for.
Yeah, you know, great family dynamics in this as well. I loved it. You know, I love the family stuff, and we got a little bit more progression with Iris and her powers she now has, which is pretty fun. But I love seeing
a little reveal, little cliffhanger last week.
Yep, and which is, it's fun seeing her get them. You know, and what happens to her shoes? I thought that was pretty funny. She's experiencing that, but seeing the villains from Earth, seeing the Johnny Quick, and seeing the Mirror Master getting into the Flash Museum, the Cosmic Treadmill. It's another one like World's Finest. I was grinning ear to ear with this stuff.
Oh, yeah. When you start getting into that stuff, you're talking Silver Age.
Yes.
DC Comics. Definitely love going back and celebrating some of the wonderful things that happened within DC and Marvel Comics in the past. So that's definitely an interesting comic book. There's another one that we need to talk about. This is your recommendation, and I definitely agree with you. Batman the Knight, number 3, Chip Zdarsky, Carmine Giadomenico. I tried it 3 times, and I think I got it that time. It has taken on new significance now that Chip Zdarsky is going to be the Batman writer. Mm-hmm. This might not be the throwaway series that I gave it credit for to begin with. Like, oh, we're going to show Batman training again. There's likely to be things happening in this comic book that will be paid off in the mainline Batman story. So if you're a big Batman reader, and you're going to read Chip Zdarsky's Batman, you might need to read this for some key elements that are going to play out in another comic.
Absolutely correct. And, you know, and Kyle and I agreed. I don't know how you feel about it, but we thought this is the best issue of the series thus far. Issues 1 and 2 were really good, but issue 3 was great. This is where it really stepped up. I mean, we see Bruce messing up, and it's fantastic. I love seeing Bruce mess up early on in his career. He's learning to be a thief as well as to be observant, and he messes that up royally, which is great. And but it forces him to be a detective, there's a great fight toward the end of the book as well. And there's a very touching moment in here too, with between him and Alfred. It is beautiful. It almost got me a little misty. I'm not going to say if it did or not, but I gotta recommend this. This was shockingly really damn good. Batman the Knight number 3.
I like the first 2 issues of this comic mm-hmm. book, but this was the problem with it is it did feel somewhat inconsequential.
Yes.
And this issue has a different feeling to it.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm really seeing stuff that we didn't see before with Bruce in his past. We're seeing those in this issue now. And we're really seeing him learn. You know, he's learning, having to learn from mistakes he's making. I love it. Being the true detective he's going to be in the future.
Absolutely. So those are your best of the week. We've got Crimson Cage, Shadow Man, Life Zero, Pentagram Before, Rad Wraith, Batman, Superman, World's Finest, The Flash, and Batman the Knight. I hope you were able to discover some comic books that you love, or maybe you have another recommendation that we didn't cover. Definitely get those in the comment section. We're trying to have a conversation about the very best comic books that came out this week. And I do want to say thank you very much to Drew for joining me. Congratulations on finally getting the books in. You got them physically in your hand. You're ready to ship them out. War to Blood 2 will be coming out in the future. And congratulations on all your success, brother.
Thank you. Thank you. And next week, for DC, I just started reading it. Action Comics, guys, you're going to want to read this. This was good.
Just this week, DC Comics announced that Christopher Priest is coming back. I have a feeling just a hunch that Drew and I are going to be talking about Christopher Priest and his Black Adam run right here on the channel for Best of the Week. Definitely check this out if you want to know what the story is all about and get excited for Christopher Priest returning to DC Comics just like Drew and myself are.